knowing how many cycles we've had of a certain load, we can use miner's roll, we can calculate damage, etc. And that all makes sense and is easy to do when we have easy things like sine waves, where we can easily tell how many sine waves we've had and we can easily tell what level they're at. But realistically, we don't usually deal with simple sine waves. We deal with things that look more like this. And how would you cycle count this? How many cycles are there? What level are those cycles? It's a little bit difficult to tell at first glance. So to be able to determine the cycles and the load history on real life data, which is much more complicated, we can use a tool called Rainflow Counting. And we'll go through and talk about how this tool works, but essentially the result is that you get the number of cycles, and the number of cycles is represented by color. So that's what this plot is. It's showing us the number of cycles. And it's also showing us the amplitude of those cycles by telling us what the starting stress is and what the finishing stress is. So this is the result of Rainflow Counting, which is essentially a cycle counting tool. And one big benefit of Rainflow Counting is we can do comparisons of two measurements to determine which one would be more damaging. So if you look at this time history from track A, and you look at this time history from track B, you might wonder which one of these is more damaging. It's difficult to tell by just looking at this time domain history. Now, if you sent both of these through Rainflow Counting and actually did a fatigue damage calculation, it would be much simpler. So we need tools like Rainflow Counting to make complicated time histories simple to understand. To be able to cycle count and get stress values for these more interesting loading histories, we use Rainflow Counting, which is a four-step method. The first step is hysteresis filtering. Next thing is peak valley filtering. Discretization is another way to reduce data size. And then the four-point counting method is where the cycles are actually going to be counted. So basically, we have three steps to simplify and reduce our trace, and then the last step is actually going to be the cycle counting. So first step is hysteresis filtering. So what we're going to do here is we're going to define an amplitude gate, so something like this yellow hysteresis gate. And we're going to take this hysteresis gate and we're going to slide it from left to right across our time history. And any variation that is smaller than this hysteresis gate is removed from our load time history. So let's say that this green is our original time history and this yellow is our hysteresis gate size. We slide this gate across our time data, and any point or fluctuation that is smaller than that gate is going to be removed. So here we have a little fluctuation, but this fluctuation is so small and it's smaller than our gate, we're just essentially going to remove that from our time data. Same thing with this guy, such a small fluctuation, doesn't really contribute to damage. Let's get rid of it. And you can adjust this hysteresis gate. If you want to skip this step, you can set the hysteresis gate to zero. So that's hysteresis filtering. And you can see the results on our original time history where we've got some little rough, jagged, very small fluctuations versus the result, which is a little bit smoother. The next thing is going to be peak valley filtering. The goal of peak valley filtering is to only keep data points which are reversals or direction changes in slope. So within a cycle, only the maximum and the minimum values actually matter when we're calculating damage. These in-between points don't have any effect on our damage calculation. So we're going to throw them out. We're only going to keep the minimums and the maximums and the minimums. So when we do our peak valley filtering, we have the before and the after, where we're just keeping these turning points. And in fact, the result is sometimes called a turning point sequence. The next thing we're going to do is what's called binning. Of course, when we have our peak valley filter, let's say our axis goes from 1 to 6, and we used a Siemens data acquisition system, which is a 24-bit system. That means that our y-axis is divided into something like 16 million discrete data points along the y-axis. So these points could be any value, and this y-axis is divided into 16 million values. We don't want to have that many unique strain values when we're doing our cycle counting. We want to have many fewer unique strain or stress values. So what we're going to do is we're going to bin the axis and adjust these points a little bit to reduce the number of unique points on our axis. So the way that that works is in this example, we're going to use 6 bins. So we had our original access, and instead of having 16 million unique points, or sorry, 16 million unique data values that we could have, we're going to reduce that number of unique values to just 6. So we're going to divide our y-axis into 6 values, and anything that isn't quite aligned with one of those values, we're just going to shift it a little bit. So see this first data value, it might be at a value of 2.1, and we're going to shift that to be centered at a value of 2, for example. Or this point here might be at a value of 4.9, but we're going to shift this to have a value of 4. So we're just doing some slight adjustments to reduce the number of unique data points. And you can change how many bins you want along your y-axis. In most software, the minimum amount of bins is usually about 64, but you can adjust the amount of bins that you want to use. Of course, more bins means that you're going to have more unique values on your Rainflow matrix. And we'll see how this binning affects the matrix a little bit more in a couple of slides. Now, step 4 is the real meat of Rainflow counting. This is the 4-point counting method. So when counting cycles for fatigue life calculations, the to and from values are going to be what we're looking at. So we're going to look at 4 consecutive points. We're basically going to look at one stress cycle, which is going to be 4 consecutive points. And we're going to define the inner stress as the stress value of 0.2, or whatever engineering unit value you're measuring. We're going to look at the value of 0.2 versus the value of 0.3. And then we're going to look at the value of 0.1 minus the value of 0.4. We're going to take the absolute value of that. And essentially what we're doing with the 4 counting method is we're trying to understand if the inner stress range is bound by the outer stress range. So if the inner stress range is bound by the outer stress range, then we're going to count it as a cycle. If the inner stress range is not bounded by the outer stress range, then we won't count it as a cycle. So in this case, if we look at the first 4 points, these inner points, points 2 and 3, are indeed bounded by the outer points 1 and 4. So we're going to count this as one cycle, which is why we have the number 1 here. It's a cycle that goes from 5, point 2 is at 5, value of 5. So we're going to say it's from 5, and it goes 2, 3. So the value went from 5 to 3, so along our 2 axis, we're going to drop that in the 3 slot. And we had one cycle that went from 5 to 3. We'll talk about this in more detail as we build up the animation as well. But essentially, we're trying to understand if the stress cycle is bounded, and if it is bounded, then we're going to count that. So let's take our original time history and go through each one of these steps. The first one is hysteresis filtering. So we're going to go through and slide our gate across, and we're going to remove any really small cycles that do not contribute to our damage. So you can see that we've cleaned up our trace a little bit. Second step was peak valley filtering. So we're going to remove all of these intermediate points and just keep the turning points, which will result in a turning point sequence. So we removed all of those intermediate points, and it went from sort of that smooth wavy line to a more jagged line, but essentially these intermediate points didn't matter, and we're only keeping the minimums and maximums of our cycles. Next, we're going to do binning. And so as I flip between these two slides, you'll be able to see how the points are adjusting between the slides. So you can see that if they weren't at the center of a bin, we're essentially going to assign the values to a center of a bin. And binning is important because the values of our bins are going to be our from and to values on our Rainflow axis. So the number of bins we choose is going to be the number of unique values we have on our from and on our to axes of our Rainflow matrix. So if we chose 64 bins, we would have 64 from values and 64 to values. If we just chose 6 bins, we would have 6 from values and 6 to values. And now the real meat of the method, which is the 4-point counting. So here we're actually going to go through and do the full four-point counting method on our Rainflow matrix. So we're going to look at the first 4 points, and we already did this one together. And the inner points are bound, and it went from 5 to 3, and it was one cycle, so we're going to drop in one count for that cycle. Then we're going to remove those points from our sequence, and we're going to start again at point 1, and we're going to look at the first 4 points. And this time are the inner stress values bound by the outer values? Well, no, they're not. The inner values exceed the outer values, so this cycle is not going to be counted. We're going to skip that, and we're no longer going to start from point one. We're going to start from point two. And you can see the inside is bound, and so this is going to be a cycle counted from two to four. And again, we have one cycle, so we're going to get a value of one. We'll start again at one now that we've removed that intermediate cycle. This one was not bound, so we'll move to the next points. This one, again, was bound, and it went from 1 to 6. So this was a very damaging cycle because it has a large amplitude. So the cycles out here and the cycles out here are going to be very damaging because they're going from large values to small values and vice versa. So we keep stepping through our rainflow matrix, and we keep counting these cycles. And you'll see that in this case, we had another cycle from 5 to 3. So we've increased our cycle count here from 1 to 2. And we keep going through and repeating this rainflow counting procedure, this counting method, until we have no more cycles left to count. And this resulting information is called the residail. And we don't just throw this away, we keep this residue in combination with our rainflow matrix. So the result of rainflow counting is we have our rainflow matrix and we have a residue. And it's important that we keep this residue because it does contain information about fairly large stress cycles. So even though it's not a closed cycle, this change here does still inflict damage on our part because you can see that it's going from low values to high values, back to low values to high values. So it's still a damaging event that we want to preserve the information about, even if it can't be added to our rainflow matrix because it is not a closed cycle. So result of our rainflow matrix is we have this plot, which hopefully makes a little bit more sense now that we've stepped through each one of these steps. And we're going to preserve the cycle amplitude because we have information about the starting stress and the finishing stress. We're going to preserve the cycle mean for the same reasons because we have the from and to values. We're going to preserve the number of cycles, the number of cycles being represented by color on our axis where the hot colors like red mean more cycles. And we're going to preserve the residue, that unclosed stress cycle. Just a zoomed in version. If we look a little bit closer, you can see that, as we've said before, we have high damaging events on these off-axis values. And then along this axis from upper left to lower right, we have very low damaging events. And these are low damaging because our from to values do not change much. So for example, from 32 to 33. That is not a very big change in our measured unit. So it's not going to inflict a lot of damage into the part. And so there are a lot of cycles that are low damage, and then hopefully you don't have very many high damaging cycles. Let's go into a piece of software called Simcenter Test Lab Neo. So I want to do some rainflow counting on some real time data. So this is the time data that I want to do rainflow counting on. To do rainflow counting in Neo, it's really simple. Under the processing tab, we have this process builder area, and you can add different methods. So if I go down to my load data analysis area, I have a rainflow method, and I can click this rainflow method, which will add it to my process. And I just connect these, my input to my rainflow. I'm gonna put my time data into my input basket, just like in TestLab Classic. And then I'm going to run this process using the run button in the lower left. So it's already done. And in my active analysis, which is data that was just recently processed, I can see I have my rainfall matrices for my lateral, long, and vertical measurements. So I'll display all three of those. I'll maximize the display so it's easier for you to see. And you can see the resulting rainfall matrices for these three directions. Now, if I wanted to adjust the properties of my rainflow matrix, I can always come under any process in my process builder and come under this properties pane and make adjustments like number of bins. We talked about that. We can make changes to the hysteresis gate, etc.